This conference will now be recorded.
Yes, I can see your screen, Karan. Thank you. I think we'll start in another couple of minutes. You're mute.
Yes. Sure, Umang bhai.
Yeah. Miss, you are requested to mute yourself. Miss Bijal, you are requested to mute yourself. I think we'll begin. Good evening to everyone. Welcome to another IDT study group meeting organized by WARC. Today's topic is very interesting. It is the various issues in recent notifications and circulars which have been passed by the CBIC. We have a very dynamic speaker today with us, Karan. I will have the very pleasant task of introducing him today. Karan is a qualified chartered accountant. He is currently associated with RJ Luthia and Associates since 2011. He is specialized in the field of service tax and GST, appearing before various appellate authority, including Mumbai CESTAT. He was a co-compiler of budget booklet published by KDOCA Association. He has delivered various talks at seminars organized by various different forums like WRC of ICI, KDOCA Association on the topic of GST, and is a contributor to various publications of the WRC. With this short introduction, I'd like to welcome Karan. The floor is all yours, and I hope we have a very interactive session.
I am bearing the loss. That is not the reason. I am not the recipient.
Vikram bhai, please unmute. Mute, sorry.
Thank you, over to you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Umang bhai, for the brief introduction. First of all, I would like to thank WARC for giving this opportunity. This being study circle, we would have an interactive session. There wouldn't be one-way traffic. There would be both-way traffic. All the issues and all that we would be taking up. There are altogether 8 to 9 issues I have taken up, and 1 or 2 important judicial decisions. With this, let us have one by one issues. Umang bhai, I would be taking the issues first and the point for discussion that the study circle have their views, and thereafter I can conclude my views. Is that okay?
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. So you can just briefly state the facts, and then once you point out the points for discussion, you know, we can open the floor up.
Okay, sure.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So my first issue is, I have circulated my questions to every one of you. Hope everyone has gone through that. So the first issue is ABC Limited, which is situated in Mumbai, has given a property and rent to XYZ Limited, which is situated in Baroda. And the property is located in Pune, that is Maharashtra. So the service provider is in Maharashtra, property is in Maharashtra, and the service recipient is in Baroda. So in the month of July 2017 to December 2017, in the initial stage of GST, ABC Limited has charged IGST on this transaction and paid the tax accordingly. So by carrying out the audit for 2017-18, GST auditor of ABC Limited has stated ABC that he has wrongly charged IGST on the said transaction, and CGST and SGST needs to be paid in view of section 12.3 read with section 8 of IGST. On being pointed out, ABC Limited immediately paid the CGST and SGST on the said transaction, and they have paid this in the month of February 2020. Thereafter, they have filed a refund claim in the month of March 2020 for the wrongly paid IGST for the period July to December 2017. So the department has issued them a show cause notice on the grounds that the refund claim filed by them is beyond the limitation period, that is 2 years as provided in section 54 read with section 14 explanation 14H. And the second point on which the department has rejected the refund claim is that the subsequently held in section 77, if you go through section 77, I have provided section 77. What section 77 provides: a registered person who has paid the central tax or state tax, as the case may be central tax or union tax, for the transaction considered by him as interstate supplies, but which is subsequently held, this is very important word, which is subsequently held to be an interstate supplies, shall be refunded under section 54. So in our case, department is telling us that subsequently held must be interpreted to mean held by department only, and suo motu determination of transaction as intrastate instead of interstate is not to be read as held by assessee himself. So whether the show cause notice issued by department is correct or not, let's have a discussion on that.
Everyone, you can unmute yourself and chip in. Yes, welcome, Rajiv bhai. So I'll start. You're okay. Mute, sir. You're mute.
Yeah, I am already there, huh, sir. I am listening to you, but I am listening to your view. I am learning from you people, sir.
Yes, sir. Nothing like that, sir. So I just so we have a recent circular which was issued by the department. Earlier, I believe this subsequently held was even interpreted by all the consultants saying that it has to be done by the department. However, they came out with a clarification. I believe it was circular number 162, where they said that even if the taxpayer is determining it, or he has subsequently realized that he was supposed to discharge tax under intrastate heads, and he has paid under interstate or vice versa, it will still be held valid, and that cannot be a ground for dismissal of rejecting the refund.
Correct, Umang bhai. Umang bhai, only one thing over here, whether leaving aside whether circular is useful to us, definitely we would be taking the circular, whether held, subsequently held, that is coming under the, if you see chapter of recovery, demand and recovery, under chapter 15 of demand and recovery. So whether demand and recovery, held is department is stating that held is to be interpreted held by department only, and it is under chapter demand and recovery. So whether department is not right in this ground?
Correct, but then again, any beneficial circular should, which you know, is beneficial to the applicant should be applied. So here, since we are in the defense, we should be in a position to convince them that this is your own circular. So you should not consider this as a ground. And since it is subsequently today, I am realizing the limitation period should not be triggered. Since I am realizing it today, the limitation period should start from today.
Okay.
And
no,
correctly,
one more legal, Umang.
Yeah, Vikram.
One more legal aspect is when the department themselves have said held means, is there a need to have a written order? Because when there is a departmental audit and during the departmental audit, if something is found out and then subsequently you are agreeing to what he has said, then is it not held by the department?
Correct, sir. In our case study, it is held by myself only. So if you give a liberal interpretation, usually held is by some third party only. You yourself cannot held. So usually what we state ki, suppose a court has held that this man is a guilty of some is guilty of some mistake. So court usually word held is to be read with someone has held us. So can we interpret this as a held with, I myself a held? Can I held myself?
Can I share something, sir?
Yes, sir. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah. Vikram, you are there, no?
Yes, sir.
Vikram, what I was trying to say here, taking your point forward, held means what? No, it is determined by a person who is authorized to do so. So you have given the example that audit party is not sitting in the shoes of assessing officer, can't do assessment, nothing. His job is to just do the audit, write the audit para, he will give you audit para, you agree, you don't agree, that is your choice, and he will just give the report. He can't held, it is his view, which may be right, may be wrong, acceptable to you, not acceptable to you, and there, based on that, there cannot be demand also, sir. Suppose your audit party raised some 1 crore rupees, say that this is your liability. Whether you accept, you don't accept, department cannot recover the money. There is nothing called held. Based on that, the department will separately issue show cause notice. There will be adjudication, and thereafter the order is part. Held means held should result into order, and thereafter it should become a demand or refund, or as the case may be. This is what is my view with limited understanding.
Okay, sir. Agreed, sir. Agreed. Another aspect to this is that when you are paying CGST, SGST, then it is an IGST tax paid without corresponding transaction underlying a supply. And whether therefore you can say that this is unauthorized tax held by the government and therefore refund is eligible. I am just putting across a separate view just for deliberation. Because once there was a supply transaction, you paid IGST. Then you are saying, no, IGST is wrongly paid. So what you have done is you have paid a tax for which the government has already realized tax by way of CGST, SGST, which you paid. Okay, when you yourself determine, then whatever interest is payable, you may have paid, you may not have paid, depending on section 77. If 77 is not applicable, say interest will automatically be applicable for that case. Now, the question will be then whether that IGST paid can be said to be tax unjustly held by the government, or extra tax amount paid for which there is no corresponding underlying supply, and therefore the refund application needs to be allowed.
Can I add your current? Anybody wants to, or Can I?
Yes, sir. So you can add thereafter. Gaurav sir wants to add something.
No, so let Gaurav does it. No problem. If he has already raised the finger, let Gaurav does it. Sorry.
Yes.
Once Gaurav finish, you let me know.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Thank you, everyone. Just a different perspective because I'm coming from Goa. I'm in Goa, and the Goa HSC department has taken a view that when they are actually handling this refund on the GST portal, they get a option to upload an order which says that this refund is due. And because of that, they have taken an interpretation that that order has to be from some other party, other authority, which is basically an order under 73 or 74. And in absence of such order, they are rejecting all refunds under this. This is a pre-circular position. After circular, I have not tried anything, but this is some new interpretation which they are floating around. So, the people may consider it also in the discussion.
Correct. Raju sir, you can add something.
Yeah, current. I'll take it forward what Vikram sir has said. What he was telling is once you have paid IGST initially, which turned out to be incorrect as per your own view, and you paid CGST later on, along with interest or without interest. So to that extent, I agree that you have paid excess tax of IGST. I do agree. And the government can't retain the excess money. That is also correct what he say. I agree. But only thing, the issue was there that a refund time limit under 54 was 2 years only. And this refund which you are going to ask because of the incorrect payment initially made by you, later on rectify, the 2 year period was a big challenge. And this amendment which has come through is notification of September, how to calculate. Now here, 77, the catch was about only held. I believe your case study is also rotating around that word held only, correct? Time barring and all. Of course, Vikram has a very valid point, but I think it is slightly separate issue, which is not part of your case study. It is definitely excess payment to government, but whether you're in your case study, you are written that department wants to reject on the base of time barred. They never say that you are not eligible for refund, but you have used the word time barred. So that means it is beyond 2 years. And this notification supports you that it is beyond 2 years because of the word held. And now government clarifies by way of this notification and then amending the rule 89 odd, saying that held means even you held. Because in GST, there is a self-assessment. And when you make the payment of taxes while filing return, there is no held. It is an assessment done by you, and which is self-assessment. That is what the law requires. And if at all department has a different view, they will issue notice as the case may be, and thereafter they will held. So held will be always followed by the notice. And assessment is on suo moto done by the assessee, and that's why this notification and the circular clarifying will come handy to you, because there are many matters rejected by the department on this ground until this amendment was been done. So this is my view, but I agree with Vikram's view that yes, it is excess payment to the government to that extent, but time limit was a main essence to till then.
Can I take an interpretation that supposedly 2 years has also passed when I have made the payment? So can
yes.
I take a stand that this is that tax is collected without authority of law?
Yes. Karan, I understand what you and Vikram were telling. So that is where the Mafatlal will come in your way. When the statute has provided 2 years time limit, government has no right to keep that money as a tax. So because that was not a tax amount itself, you have paid the amount by mistake as a tax, but it was never due to the government. So it will go to that fund, welfare fund. But you will not get it. And there are many decisions to that. Mafatlal is a landmark, but there are many decisions. Once you go, of course, one or two decisions are concerned, which are of the High Court. Nataraj Venkat is concerned, Karnataka High Court. And one more of Mumbai Tribunal is also there, some construction company, Bombay High Court. What is that?
Parijat Construction.
Paritaj Construction. That is Mumbai High Court. There they have said, yes, it is not. But I think still Supreme Court is not in your favor. So in my view, it will be very risky that to argue, saying that this amount not due to the government, hence it is not taxed and the time limit does not apply, will be very, very risky to that extent, in my view. But anyway, it's open to the debate and litigation also to that extent. Thank you.
Sir, anyone wants to add anything?
I just wanted to just ask whether if department is not contesting that your refund application is valid, it is just saying on time barring and everything, can you not say that today they have held that it is a CGST transaction which was paid as IGST, and from today the limitation period starts?
No, Umang, I didn't got you. You are trying to tell that today the department has held, but sir, in our case study, department has never held. Me Suo Motor.
So I am saying, I am interpreting it from the other end. See, what they are saying is it is time barred. They are not denying the fact that it is it was an IGST or CGST SGST transaction which you paid as I, right? Okay. So today they are technically determining or holding that it is a intrastate transaction. So from today they are it is held, and therefore you know you can say that 2 years is starting from today. Okay. Just you, some point you of view. There is no answer to something I wanted.
Okay, got it. Valid point. So the Umang bhai was speaking about the circular 162. In that circular, they have interpreted the term subsequently held. And in that, they had told ki subsequently held covers both the cases. One where taxpayer himself has has held that. And in second one, tax officer has found out in both the cases, this would be applicable. So accordingly, refund claim under the section can be claimed by the taxpayer in both the above situation. Now coming to time bar. So for time bar, there is a new proviso has been inserted with effect from by notification 35/2021 dated 24 September 21. In that proviso, they have held they have inserted a new proviso stating that in any person claiming refund under section 77 of any tax paid by him in respect of transaction considered by him to be interstate, which is subsequently held by intrastate supplier before the expiry of period of 2 years from date of payment of tax on interstate supply, file an application. So, and they have come up with one more proviso which states that provided that said application may on as regards to any payment of tax and interstate supply before commencement of this sub rule be filed before 2 years. So suppose today you have in our case study, you are held in the month of March 2020, you have made the payment. So at that time there was no provision to safeguard you from time bar period, because our period was July 17 to December 17, for which refund needs to be filed before December 2019, and you have filed in March 2020. So with this clarification, we can go ahead and tell that the last day for filing refund claim would be 24th of September 2020. That is, this notification came from 24th of February 21. From there, you need to pick up 2 years. That comes to 23rd or 24th of September 2023. So with this, we can conclude that for this case study that subsequently held is both either by the taxpayer himself or the tax authority. And second, this is not a time barred matter since the new proviso, new sub rule has been new rule has been inserted 89(1)(a). For 89(1)(a) for claiming refund of wrongly paid tax. Now coming to our next case study. This is a very interesting case study. I will just
I wanted to ask something.
Hello, yeah, Bhushan, tell me.
Yeah, in the previous slide of that refund claim time barring one, you just mentioned that as per the notification, the payment was made in February 20 or March 20.
Right.
Okay. So the time begins from February 20, February or March 20, as per this provision. Not from September 21.
As per this,
But new tax, the correct tax was paid as per the as per the first para. I mean that 2 years from the date of payment of tax under the correct head. Correct. So we made the payment on March 20. So it will be 2 years from March 20.
Correct. No, March 20, but there was no such provision. So what this government wants to tell, ki the provided that the said application payment.
So he's referring to the second proviso.
Yes.
Okay. Second proviso. Okay. Before coming into this sub rule, the from the date on which this sub rule came into force. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Got it. Thank you so much. Sorry for the disturbance.
No. Now coming to second case study. This is a very interesting one. A.R. Rahman has entered into an agreement with the T series for transferring IPR of music composed song Chale Chalo for a consideration of 5 crore on 15 September 21. And at the same very day, he has received 50% as an advance. A.R. Rahman has received 50% as an advance. Now that music rights, the A.R. Rahman has composed the song and given the music rights to T series on 15th October 21. This is the date when his service has been completed. Now, invoice for the same was raised on 15th October 2021. Now, the balance payment of 50% was given by T series to A.R. Rahman on 25th of January 2022. So, here issue comes, what is the GST liability to be discharged? This issue has been taken because by notification 6/2021, the rate of IPR has been reduced, has been increased from 6% to 9%. So now coming to our case study, whether AR on what amount ARM T series would require to make payment, because this is covered under reverse charge mechanism. Reverse charge mechanism is the music composer service provided by music composer to a music company is under reverse charge mechanism as per notification 13/2017. So views on this. Anyone?
Can I?
Yeah.
So if I refer to section 14 for change in rate of tax, we have to look at basically the scenarios. So here the service was completed before the rate changed, correct?
Correct.
The invoice was raised before the rate change. Partial payment was received before, partial payment was received after. Since two major aspects, that is invoice and completion, happened before, the old rate should apply, correct?
Oh yeah, correct.
So accordingly, you will have to discharge rate of tax based on the old and accordingly RCM is to be paid on the old rate, irrespective of, it's like an extension of the original supply. Say today, before the rate changed, you supplied goods worth rupees 100, and or let's say you sold goods worth rupees 100 and paid tax of 5 rupees. Then tomorrow you realize that you are supposed to raise a bill of 150. Between that date, the rate changed. So this debit note which you will raise is an extension of the original supply. So something like that is to be applied even in this scenario, where it is an extension of the original supply only, and the rate which was prevalent at that date should apply. So accordingly, even RCM has to be paid on the old rate.
Okay.
That is my view. I may be incorrect. Yes, if someone wants to share.
Yes. Anyone want to share? I have a little bit of, let us go one by one on this.
Yeah.
First of all, this is under RCM that everyone agrees, correct?
Yes.
Now coming to time of supply for RCM, that is section 13.3. What does section 13.3 say? In case of supplies in respect of which tax is due to be discharged under RCM, the time of supply shall be earlier of the following days. First one, date of payment has entered into the books of account of recipient or date on which payment is debited. So in our case study, our first advance was received, advance was given to AR Sreeman on 15th of September. Therefore, T series, by going by section 13.3, T series 13.3A, T series would require to make reverse charge mechanism payment. Correct? Now,
yes.
Now in between the rate change. So whether question comes whether T series was required to issue the invoice for this. According to section 31.3F and 31.3G, under reverse charge, a person who is liable to pay under section 90 or 94 shall issue an invoice in respect of goods or services of both received by him from supplier who is not registered on the date of receipt of goods or services. So in our case, we have not received the goods or services. We have received the goods on 15th of October 2021. So I am not required to raise the invoice for reverse charge also. Self-invoice, I don't have to make. T-series. Now, what does G clause says? A registered person who is liable to pay tax under 9.3 or 9.4 shall issue a payment voucher at the time of making payment to supplier. So T series would issue a payment voucher and accordingly he would discharge the tax liability because of 13.3. Correct?
Yes.
Now coming to the change in rate of tax. What does change in rate of tax say? Notwithstanding anything contained in section 12 or 13, where there is a change in rate of tax of goods or services of both shall be determined in following manner, namely, in that D clause, in case of goods or service of both have been supplied after the change in rate of tax. So what is the interpretation of supplied? Whether this is actual supplied or it is supply as per section 7. I just want to know the what the group says about this.
So according to you, you said 15th October was the date when he raised the invoice, and that is when the service has said to have completed.
And the actual services are already provided on 15th, because he has given that service on 15th itself. In my question, if you see, actual music rights were given by ARMN to TC on 15th October only.
Correct. So then the service is rendered or completed on 15th October.
Correct. Correct.
That is when the supply is completed, and this is not a continuous supply. So this is a normal singular service supply. So then on 15th of October is your date of supply.
Date of supply, correct. So now I have made the payment of advance as per 13.3 on suppose on 2 crore 50 lakh at the rate of 6%, because at that time rate was 6%.
Correct.
Now the rate has changed in between when I am making the invoice. So I would be falling by B3, where invoice has been issued after the change in rate of tax. So I had issued invoice on 15th of October 2021, but the payment is received before. I have received part payment at 2 crore 50 lakh before, that is on 15th September. The supply shall be the date of issue of invoice. So here there are two time of supply triggering. One because of 13.3, and now because I have issued the invoice, I have to again recalculate that thing. Again, I have to recalculate tax on 2 crore 50 lakh.
No, but I have a question. The invoice was raised before the change in rate, correct? It was raised on 15th of October.
So the change in rate was for 1st October, no?
Oh, 1st October, right, right. Sorry. Right.
So, Pushinji, you want to add something?
Sorry.
Yeah, I'm just going. If anyone else wants to, please, you can unmute yourself.
So here, in my view, you will need to again recalculate the tax on that supply. In the reverse charge, you have already paid a 2,50,000 at rate of a 6%. And at the time of making the invoice, when there is a change in rate of tax, then you need to again recalculate on entire 5 crore and pay the tax accordingly. But here one more issue is there. Whether this change in rate of tax is applicable to reverse charge mechanism? Because if you read section 14, no, everywhere they have provided the word where the payment is received after the. So in reverse charge mechanism, payment is not received, payment is made. Correct? The recipient makes the payment. And the explanation also states that date of receipt of payment shall be the date on which payment is entered into books of account of the supplier, or the date on which payment is credited to his bank account, whichever is earlier. So as a recipient, I would never be knowing that when the supplier enter the payment in his book of account, or when the amount has been credited to his bank account. So can we take an argument that section 14 is not applicable for RCM transaction?
So it is often argued that in RCM, you step into the shoes of the supplier, and all the other than specific sections, all everything is applicable as if you were the supplier. So correct. Won't section 14 apply?
If you recollect service tax, there was similar provision for reverse charge mechanism. You fall into the shoes of this. So for in service tax regime, they came up with a specific rule 7 POT, where what is section 14 now, no, was already there in the service tax regime also, as it is there copy pasted there. And one more rule was there in service tax, which states that provided also that when there is a change in liability or extent of liability of person required to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism, in case service has been provided and invoice has been issued before the date in change, all that thing. So this rule is missing in GST era. So can we again argue over here that because of absence of this rule, such rule, section 14 is not applicable to RCM?
Rajiv bhai, your views?
About the point of tax. Hello, am I audible? No?
Yeah, yes, go ahead.
Yeah, the first issue is whether there is a change in rate of tax or no is one point. Because you have made a payment in September and supply has happened after September, that of service and invoice is also raised after the September only. So whether there is a change in rate of tax, and that is being defined in section, what is the section, 13?
14.
14, 14. 14. So now only thing is the, yes, of course, the change in rate of tax, though it has been defined here in GST, this point of taxation rule were there in old regime service tax also. The only thing is concerned for reverse charge mechanism liability, the change in rate of tax, there was a separate provision in the old rule, which you have talked about. As against that, here there is nothing, there is only common rule, because section 14 is concerned, so only one section. Only the wording of section 14 is going in a way that as if that it is applicable only for forward charge. That is a kind of impression, very, very proactive interpretation. I have my own doubt on that. But I personally feel there is a change in rate of tax for sure in this case. And it is getting covered within section 14, although the wordings of all the sub clauses of 14 is as if that it is a service provider's perspective. But I think it is, if you look at the wordings of 14, it starts with notwithstanding anything contained in 12, 13, the time of supply. So supply is not vis-a-vis supplier or receiver, but it is vis-a-vis goods or service. And goods or service, that's my view is concerned, 14 should be applicable to both for reverse charge and forward charge. Going by that analogy and with that interpretation, I will say that there is a definitely change in rate of tax in that. And when you are receiving the payment in the month of September, rather you made the payment in the month of September. So reverse charge, you will have to make the payment of tax, but there will not be any invoice. It will be advance voucher. And on that, we'll make the payment at the rate of 12%. 6% was the rate in September. Actual supply turned out to be post 1st October. And that time, the rate is 18%. And at that point of time, the actual transaction of supply has happened. But the only thing is the definition of supply includes agreeing to supply. Now, in my view, definition of supply, definitely it includes agreeing to supply. But here the supply transaction gets complete actually in the month of October, post 1st October. 18% should have been paid there. And while making payment on entire 5 crore, you take a credit of whatever 12% you paid on 2.5%, deduct that and make the payment. Of course, that is what is my view as far as this is concerned.
Any other view on this? Harsh Bhai, Hiten. Okay. So, we are taking that there is a very proactive view stating that. That rule for section 14 is not applicable in GST regime. Now going to the next question, issue number 3. ABC Limited is engaged in business of printing journals and newsletters. XYZ has approached ABC for printing 1000 journals in August 2021, wherein content would be provided by XYZ Limited. ABC would use its own paper and ink for printing the said job. The total value would be 50 lakh for this job work. XYZ has given 20 lakhs as an advance to ABC on 1st of September 2021. Then in the month of November 2021, XYZ ABC has completed the job work assignment and raised the invoice on 30th November 2021. So in this also, he wants to know the tax liability. So here also, there was a change in rate of tax. What was that amended notification? Notification 6/2021, entry 27-1 was omitted from 1st of October 2021. In that omitted entry, GST rate was 6% for service by way of printing of all goods, including newspaper, journals, periodicals, where only content is supplied by the publisher and physical input, including paper used for printing, belongs to the printer. So in our case study also, this is the same thing. The content has been given by the publisher, that is XYZ, and ABC is using his own printing papers, inks and all that thing. So we are hit by this change amendment, and our GST rate is increased to 9%, from 6% to 9%. So this is a forward charge, correct? So here also the same issue comes up, ki when the job work, when I have given made an agreement for job work on 10th of August, and I have given an advance of 20 lakh rupees. So on that advance, whether I need to pay tax or no. So this being a service transaction, I need to make payment at the earliest of the following date of issue of invoice or the date of payment as per section 13(2). But over here, one explanation is there. The supply shall be deemed to have been made to the extent it is covered by an invoice or, as the case may be, the payment. So what does this mean? Anyone can explain this? How about this explanation? Okay. So,
You can ask someone to speak, you can ask someone to speak if you want.
Okay. Sanjay Pawarji, can you explain this explanation? Sanjay Pawarji? Harsh Bajaj?
Continue. Go ahead.
Okay. So, the issuance of invoice. Section 31.2 provides a registered person supplying taxable service shall, before or after the provision of service but within a specified period, issue a tax invoice showing the description and all that. So either I can make the invoice prior of provision of service or at the time of provision of service or within 30 days as provided in rule 47. So in my case, I have completed my service in month of November and I have raised bills on 30th November 2021. That is within 30 days from the date of completion of service. So I have complied with section 31.2 also. So now this is a change in rate of tax. Because at the time of giving of advance, the tax liability, the rate of tax was 6%, that is 12%. And now when I'm actually making the supply of service, the tax rate has increased to 18%. So here also there's an issue, notwithstanding containing section 12 or 13. So I don't have to look at 12 or 13. What I did in 12 or 13, you have to ignore that and again check for change in rate of tax. So in this case, where invoice has been issued after the change in rate of tax. So I have issued invoice on 30th November, but payment, advance payment was received before the 30th, before the change in rate of tax, that is 1st October 21. Therefore, I would be hit by the provision of B3 and I have to again make the payment on the date of issue of invoice. So here also, again, I have to suppose there is a contract for 20 lakhs. I have already discharged my tax liability of 12%, which comes to 2,40,000. Again, I have to recalculate on 2,40,000. That would become 3,60,000. I have to make a differential payment of 1,20,000. So this is the third issue we have completed. Any doubt till here? Okay, going forward, issues in recent circulars. This question is XYZ INC, that is XYZ Limited, is located in UK, that is outside India, has entered into an agreement with the universities which are also located outside India. So suppose Oxford University is there. And the service to be rendered to Oxford University by XYZ are market the various courses and enroll student for from India for courses conducted by university. Means XYZ INC UK has to market the courses of Oxford University and enroll the students of India to their courses. Second, he has to consult, advise, arrange and organize tours, visit for representation of representatives of Oxford University to various schools. Means Oxford University, the guys will be coming to India. For them, I have to advise, arrange, organize the tour, visit, etc. Third job I have to do is develop content and design for course material for students. So Oxford University would be having some courses going on. I have to design that course and give the material of the course to them. And fourth one is coordinating with students for completing the enrollment process. These are the four services which XYZ UK has to undertake for Oxford University. Now, XYZ for carrying out this this job, XYZ INC UK has entered into a contract with ABC Education India Private Limited. Means they have given some of part of the work to ABC India. And as per their agreement, the what all the ABC India has to provide. First one, they have to counsel, advise, and arrange college, high school visit in India for representative of Oxford University. Correct? Second is develop content and design course material for client of XYZ INC. This is the two object that XYZ was also giving, XYZ UK was going to give to foreign client. Now, third one is carrying out research and prepare study report about various schools and education across India. And fourth is carrying out research on various courses offered by foreign university and give suggestion for their suitability for Indian students. Means I have to carry out a research and see which all courses are suitable to Indian, like marketing courses suitable for Indian students. So I have to tell my principal, XYZ UK, that you do a research, or you tell your principal that marketing is much more preferred in India. And for this, the consideration given by XYZ UK to ABC Indian party is €5,000 per month. ABC India is neither responsible nor accountable for enrolling any student for courses of foreign university. Means whether the student comes, don't come, there are 5 students, there are 1,000 students, that doesn't matter. ABC would get €5,000 entire with them. Now the department has issued an show cause notice stating that this is an intermediary services and liable to GST GST in India. So ABC wants to know what is the course of action. Anyone?
I think let's first discuss the definition of intermediary. Then yes. We'll take each part separately.
Yes. What is in my section 213? 213 defines intermediary service means a broker, an agent, or any other person by whatever name called who arranges or facilitates the supply of goods or services or both or securities between two or more persons, but does not include a person who supplies such goods or services of both or securities on his own account. This is a definition of intermediary services. So whether ABC India is arranging or facilitating the services of services to XYZ for rendering their services to their foreign part, Oxford University, is the question. Anyone?
Can you open each service so that we can discuss separately?
Yeah. First service given by ABC to XYZ INC is consulting, advising, or arranging college, high school visit in India for representative of Oxford University.
So for consulting and advising, it is a principal to principal supply.
Okay, correct.
It is not intermediary for arranging college, high school visit. However, if I were to refer to section 13 IGST, place of supply, will 13.3 trigger where physical presence is required?
Physical presence is required, correct.
So will that trigger in this scenario where ABC Education Private Limited is helping XYZ or his beneficiary, that is his client Oxford, to come and visit colleges in India, and it requires their physical presence. So that place of supply will change for that specific service.
Okay, but usually what this ABC XYZ would tell, XYZ would tell that 1-3% are coming to India, you arrange. You arrange for their stay. They would require 5-star hotel. For 5-star hotel, they would be visiting on one day to Chandigarh, one day to Delhi. Like that, he would tell. So whether then that the job of ABC would be to search out for plane tickets, then he has to accommodate in 5-star hotel, arrange the visit at the schools in which that Oxford University guy wants to go, all that thing. So whether this is a bundle supply, can we argue that this is arranging is an incidental?
Yes, I believe you can. Then it goes with the consulting and advising role. Then you may be in a position to argue that it is a incidental supply and therefore goes out.
Correct. What about the second question? Develop, contain, and design course material for client of XYZ. That is for Oxford University.
That is, I believe, pure P2P, right? There is no agency involved.
Correct.
Similarly for the rest, I believe.
Carrying out research and prepare a study report and both. Means you mean to say this is not an intermediary service. This is basically a support service given by ABC Limited to XYZ INC.
Correct. Management or support service. Correct.
Correct.
Anybody has any other? Vikram bhai?
Yes.
Your views.
Hello.
Vikram bhai, your views.
I'm sorry, some problem is there over here. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
I am in agreement with your views, Karan. Would not like to add much because this is a topic which is very, very discussed, and a lot of circulars and books are also there on it.
Correct.
So I agree with you.
Correct. I would just like to draw attention of circular 159, recently issued circular of 20th September 2021, wherein department clarified that from pursual of definition of intermediary service under IGST Act as well as under service tax law, it is evident that there is broadly no change in scope of intermediary service in GST regime vis-a-vis service tax, except addition of supply of security. So with this, we can have a strong ground stating that whatever decisions are there in the service tax regime about intermediary services, same would be applicable over here in GST regime also. So all the decision of GoDaddy and all that thing would be applicable in GST law as well. Further, the circular states that primary requirement for intermediary services are five. Minimum, there should be minimum three parties. Means, suppose you are purchasing shares of Reliance. So you will tell your broker. There are three parties. First one is you, second is the broker, and the third one is your exchange or the person who gives you the Reliance shares. So there are mere three parties. So in intermediary service, broker would be an intermediary services, minimum three parties. Second, two distinct supply. There are two distinct supply. One is purchase of shares and another is the transaction facility of providing that shares to you. Third one is service provided to a character of agent, broker, or similar. So that stock broker would be a person who will be a broker in between he would be a bridge between the two persons. A and B, he would be bridge for facilitating supply. Fourth, it does not include a person who supplies such goods or services or both on his own account. So obviously broker won't be giving on his own account. And third, or subcontracting for a service is not an intermediary service. So in our example also, all this condition are fulfilled. First one, minimum three parties. Over there, ABC Education. And he has contracted with XYZ INC of UK. So there are two parties, and third party is Oxford University. But I, as a service provider, I have no role to play with Oxford University. Whatever my principal says me, ki you have to do this work. You have to arrange the visit. I have to arrange the visit. Whoever comes, intermediate services, the intermediate will always be knowing his main both the principals. In our case, ABC would not be knowing the Oxford University's. Second is two distinct supply also not there. There is only one supply of support service given by ABC to XYZ INC. Third one, he is not a broker, agent or similar person. Fourth is, does not include a person who supplies such goods or services on his own account. So ABC is providing on his own account, supplies on his own account. And fourth one is subcontracting is not an intermediary. In our case, it is a purely an example of subcontracting. XYZ, Oxford University has told to do five things to XYZ UK. Out of that five things, four things have been subcontracted to ABC. So this is an subcontracting. So in our case study, this is not an intermediary services. This is a pure support service. Umang, can we go to next case study?
Yeah, please.
Now issue number five. XYZ Shipping Limited, located in Delhi, located in India, is a subsidiary of XYZ USA Shipping Company. Means this is one is subsidiary and one is holding company. US one is a holding company and XYZ is a subsidiary company. They have entered into an agreement. And the XYZ India has to provide following services: monitor the shipping freight market and keep the holding company fully informed about all the key developments in market. Means he has to look out for all the updates in the market, what are the shipping prices going on, per ton price going on, etc., etc. Second one is keeping the holding company informed of government regulation, tariff, taxes, relating to shipping freight. So government has changed some policy. He has they are allotted MEIS license. So he has to tell his principal that India they have changed the policy. Third one, submit business report to holding company as required. So the holding company would like to know which is the most traveled destination or something like that. In consideration for the said services, applicant is paid service fees in form of cost plus applicable markup. The cost include all direct and indirect cost incurred by queries, including salaries, insurance, etc., etc. So suppose my this month expenditure of salary, insurance, rent is 5 lakh rupees. So on that I have to put up a markup say 10%. So I have to bill them 5,50,000 in US currency. The consideration is paid by holding company in convertible foreign exchange. XYZ has treated this transaction as export of service since all the conditions of export of service are fulfilled. First one, the supplier of service is located in India. Recipient is located outside India. He has received amount in convertible foreign exchange. Place of supply, which will be governed by general rule, is the location of the recipient, which is outside India. And it is not merely an extra. Now the only issue over here is that department has issued them a show cause notice on the fifth ground, which states that ABC, that XYZ holding company is merely an establishment of distinct person. So foreign party is carrying on business through a branch or agency or representation office of tax payer located in India, and that is liable to be treated as establishment in India, therefore such transaction does not qualify as export. Whether the contention of department is correct? Can we have a view on this?
Yes, Rajiv bhai, I think we'll hear you first. This is a very touchy topic.
I don't mind responding on that. This is a live case study he has taken.
Basically, two things are there. The services are being provided. Actually, current in the facts of the case, it is a holding company and subsidiary. No, you have stated.
Yes, holding and subsidiary.
So first of all, it is not a distinct person. That is the first thing. Section 25, the distinct person being NVSA, that is not the case over here. Secondly, because both are independent company incorporated in under two separate law of two different country. Secondly, the nature of services, the scope which is given. Can you go to the slide where the scope is covered? Yes. Nature of service. So here, monitor the freight market. So perhaps the foreign company, holding company, wants that Indian company to give update about the movement in the freight, what is the market conditions, etc., etc. Perhaps based on that, they can determine their pricing policy. Perhaps that is the reason. Otherwise, so the job is to keep the give the information related to market condition in the shipping line related to freight, etc. That is first. Secondly, government regulations, tariffs and taxes on the shipping industry, on the freight specifically. That so this second. And third is the business reports to holding company as may be required. So business report means they may say client profile across India geographically, like that. They may be giving various information. So basically, if you look at the scope here of the services which is rendered by the Indian company, is giving information as required by the principal located outside India. Principal in the sense the holding company, I'm sorry. So they are not required to get any business basically. The inquiry from customer, trying to attract the customer or get the business for freight, nothing of that kind. But they have to just keep giving the reports or monitor and give the information as sought by. So this, in my view, first of all, if you are trying to think from the intermediary perspective, this is not intermediary perspective because this is a only two parties. There is missing third party is missing first of all in the entire transaction. Secondly, it's a only services that of supplying of the information, which is more of a support service. And in my view, the POS is concerned will go outside India, and they are not a distinct company also. Thereby, this can be termed as an export of services, and they can pay, need not pay GST. Without GST, by LUT, they can, raise the invoice on that. Your questions were there about taxability, no?
Yes, sir. The department is on the allegation that this is merely an establishment of distinct person.
So merely establishment of a distinct person means the entity should be the same. Like a holding company is established outside India in whichever country you have mentioned. And if they open a branch in India or their license office in India after taking permission from the respective government authority, then there will not be a separate incorporation. And then that will be a branch or license office. This will be establishment of the same entity in that scenario. Here it's a subsidiary company. Subsidiary company means that is separately incorporated in India with a certain percentage, maybe 51% or more than that is held by the foreign company, correct? That is how only it has become holding company. So both are separate entity altogether. I think there is a circular, no? Refer September month, there is a circular on this.
Yes.
So this can be treated as, so thereby it cannot be distinct person. And establishment of this, and then this will be transaction, in my view, should be the export of services.
Correct. Sir, Ayu sir has rightly referred to a circular. Department has issued another circular 161 by 17 by 2021, dated 20th September 21, which specifically said that if it is clarified that a company incorporated in India and a body corporate incorporated by or under any law of country outside India, which is also referred to as foreign company under Companies Act, are separate person under CGST Act and thus are separate legal entities. So in our case also, ABC XYZ Limited India is incorporated in India, and another company XYZ Shipping Inc. is incorporated in US. So they both are a separate person for IGST. Accordingly, these two separate person would not be considered as merely an establishment or distinct person. Department was issuing show cause notices on this, that holding and subsidiary are one and the same. They are just acting as an agency, branch offices, all that thing. So now it is a well settled law that by giving this circular, department has put down the litigation, stating that they are not a merely an establishment distinct person. And it is just clarified, it would not be treated as supply between establishment and distinct person. One or two important case law in this. One is that of Vodafone International. In that, Supreme Court has held that it is fairly well settled and accepted that a subsidiary and parent are totally distinct taxpayer. Nowadays, it is fairly well settled that for tax treaty purpose, subsidiary and its parent are also total separate and distinct taxpayer. So we can also see that Supreme Court also held that holding and subsidiary are a separate and distinct taxpayer for purpose of taxation in India. And one more, there was an AAR in case of Belhar Hella Thermo Control India Private Limited, wherein it was observed that subsidiary company are not merely an establishment distinct person. Is this all right? Any questions on this issue?
No, I believe, so even if they were to say that, you know, it is establishment of distinct person, as far as it is a liaison office, we have, I think, a couple of AARs which say that liaison office is not supposed to discharge GST. I believe the one which I can remember is Habufa Mubelin, where the Rajasthan advance ruling held that it does not have any other say other than the services which is supposed to render to its head office, and therefore it is a liaison office and not subject to GST.
Correct. Yes. Anyone else who can contribute on this? Okay. Now yeah, going go forward. Now sixth issue. This is most ABC Limited is engaged in business of selling inverter and UPS system. Along with UPS inverter, ABC also sells its batteries. Means he also sells UPS with batteries, only batteries you require, he sells only UPS, he sells. So PQR has placed an order for purchase of 10 inverter inverter system inclusive of batteries. Means he wants batteries as well as inverter. So ABC want to know the what GST rate he should charge on this. Yes. I would just like to add that inverter rate is 18% and battery rate is 28%.
So is this on the issue that the department wants to say that battery is a separate supply and the UPS and inverter is a separate supply?
Correct. First of all, let us try to read what is mixed supply. Understand that mixed supply, composite supply, and principal supply. What is mixed supply? Mixed supply means two or more supplies of goods or services or combination thereof made in conjunction with each other by taxable person for a single price, where such supply does not constitute a composite supply. Correct? So there should be two distinct supply and they should be made for a single price. Is a mixed supply. For example, if we go to the Shopper Stop, so there's a watch as well as there is a glass. So that is a, and they are selling it in a combo. So they are two distinct supplies, and they are selling for a single price. So it is a mixed supply, and the highest tax liability would be applicable in the case of mixed supply. In case of composite supply means a supply made by a taxable person to a recipient consisting of two or more taxable supplies of goods or services which are naturally bundled and supplied in conjunction with each other in ordinary course of business, one of which is a principal supply. the example for this would be compute supply would be if you go to the hotel for staying. So breakfast is naturally bundled with the staying. So it is a composite supply. And the principal supply means the supply of service is considered predominant element of supply to which other forms of composites is an ancillary one. So principal supply is the main supply, and another supply should be a composite, should be ancillary one to become a composite supply. So here in our example, ABC is selling inverter along with batteries. So whether it is a mixed supply or a composite supply, anyone can tell? So the I just want to know whether inverter can work without batteries. Work with so inverter cannot work without batteries. So in my view, this is a composite supply, because it is obviously key. If I am going to take inverter along with batteries, batteries standalone don't have anything, or inverter standalone don't have. Both when supplied together in a would only constitute a supply. So they are naturally bundled with each other. So, but government has issued a circular 163/19/2021 or 6th October, where they are clarified. Clarification was sought whether UPS system inverter sold along with batteries. So in our example also, it is sold along with batteries as an integral part are classified under heading 8507 at 28%. That is whether they are classified under batteries or they are classified under 8504, which is an inverter, and 18% would be applicable. Department has clarified, even if the UPS inverter and external batteries are sold on the same invoices, the price is separately known and they are two separate identifiable items. Can you tell me whether these two are two identifiable items? Whether inverter can work without batteries or battery stand alone can work without inverter? So in my opinion, this is not a good circular. This will definitely be an issue that department would raise a show cause notice if your client is in the business of this and he is selling inverter along with batteries and he is charging 18% tax considering the composite supply. Then department will take this contrary view going by this circular.
Can I add something here?
Yes, sir.
In your view, you are saying that this is not mixed supply, but it is composite supply, correct?
Correct, sir.
In both the case, there has to be, whether it is mixed or composite, there has to be two supply, first of all.
Huh.
So where are two supply? In my view, it's only one supply. Where are two supply? Because in your question, you have written that it is a system. So you take out your case studies.
Yes.
Your question, where is your question?
Sir,
you have written UPS selling inverter and UPS systems. You have written word system. So sir, when you talk about system, no, system includes inverter and the batteries. I mean to say battery is a part of the system.
Correct.
See, when I'm purchasing UPS or inverter as the case, see, UPS is concerned, it requires charging and then it will continue to work for some time, you know, in with the inbuilt battery. But when it is inverter is concerned, the battery will go along with it. And I personally feel that it is only one system putting together. Like you buy a car, no, battery is inbuilt within that. And you can't say, I have purchased car with battery. Battery is a part of the car. So can't you say like that? Can't you have this kind of thinking? And then there is only one supply. Where are two supplies? So I will say there is a solo supply rather than a mixed supply or, composite supply.
Correct.
So I don't know. Technically, I am trying to interpret. The battery is there in car also, like it is there in inverter also. So can you make, thereby you can split the products?
No. Only one thing is that in UPS and inverter, In usually market UPS and inverter and batteries, if I want separately, I can have that separately. But as you mentioned, the inverter system is there. So it is obviously known that it is along with batteries also.
But Karan, in my car also, the life of battery is 2-3 years. My car is going on, and after 2-3 years, I change the battery. So that time I am purchasing only battery, not the car. But in your question, you have written system. So it is as good as new car purchase, which includes the battery. So in your system, no battery is included. That is what I presume. If I sell inverter system, and then I need not write including batteries. It is a definitely inbuilt. It's a part. Like I purchase computer system, no, the keyboard is obviously there.
This
is what I am trying to say. But then later on, if your keyboard is spoiled, you can purchase separately keyboard. That I understand. Then it becomes part of the computer, but not to say otherwise. Keyboard has no utility. No, without computer, can it work? No point in that. That is what I was trying to highlight.
Umang bhai, your views?
I was also thinking on this line that, you know, why are we going into composite and mixed? And I agree with Rajiv sir. Yeah, please.
Vikram bhai, your views?
I fully agree with Rajiv sir. See, the question is, when you're saying that it is a system, you have out of abundant precaution, you know, written that it includes this also, this also. But even if you write simply an inverter system and you would have not written battery also, you would have supplied that battery.
Correct.
So I think I fully agree with Rajiv bhai, because when you're saying system, it is not a standalone purchase of two separate things. The circular is absolutely incorrect.
Correct, sir. So now going to our next issue. This is Rebel Food. This Passos and all that is a Rebel Food company. Rebel Food is engaged in business delivering food through cloud kitchen concept. What is mean by cloud kitchen? They don't have any kitchen, they don't have any restaurant per se, where you can have, you can sit and have the food. They only have the kitchen, and you can get the food through the delivery mode only. So Rebel Food does not have any restaurant wherein you can consume food. It only has kitchen wherein food is prepared and delivered to this delivery partner like Swiggy and Zomato. So Rebel Food wants to know the GST liability on said supply of food. Can anyone? What is the rate? Mere supply of food. Whether it is a restaurant,
if you refer to the definition, they are saying consuming food on or away from, and then they write eating house. Can, if you have it pointed, yeah.
This is the definition.
On or away from the premises provided by restaurant, eating joint, mess, canteen, etc. So we have a tribunal decision in case of Jumbo Vada Pav. Maharashtra tribunal decision in case of Jumbo Vada Pav, where even just it was a small stall where there was, there is a small place where he actually gives the Vada Pav to you, where even that was is held as a restaurant. It was a VAT judgment and it was against the party. However, in GST, it is beneficial where it was held that it is a restaurant. So here also, what I'm trying to say is, it may not have the licenses it requires to run a restaurant. However, the intention of the government seems to be that, you know, all these comes under a broad spectrum of restaurant service, and it is like an eating joint where only delivery is there, and therefore all takeaway, door delivery, everything where consumption is happening away is also restaurant, and therefore should be taxed at the rate restaurant service is charged.
But Umang bhai, if you refer to one of the judgment of Madras High Court, Anjapar Chettiar AC Restaurant, wherein the court has held that the sale of food and drink simpliciter, means simply you are selling food or drink, would not attract service tax. Why this court is telling like that? Because court is telling for the restaurant service, for attracting service tax, there should be, means when you're going to a restaurant, you don't go only for food. You go for music. You go for the good decor is there. I go to Taj for its view and all that thing. So all that is a service is given. So if I am going to Taj, then that is a restaurant service. Just merely I am taking a food from Jumbo King. That is not an. It is just a food simplicator. So it is a. So it has held that in case of takeaway or parcel, the official attributes are absent. Means services are absent. Therefore, home food and drink taken away from restaurant tantamount to sale of food and drink and does not attract service tax. So court is telling me that merely the taking away parcel is not a tantamount to service, it's tantamount to sale of goods. So what are our views on this?
So here I believe what the government is trying to argue is that there is some element of services which are being rendered. I agree where there is some iota of doubt here, where you know it becomes like a sale of goods. How conveniently they are saying for ice cream that it is sale of goods, while right. at the same time for everything else they are saying it is a restaurant service. Right. Where in the ice cream they are arguing that there is no element of cooking which is happening, and in cloud cooking there is some cooking which is happening, and therefore you know it is not sale of goods.
Okay. So what's the view whether this circular is good or this circular is obviously helpful to us because
so actually
not necessarily
if you look
helpful from, for everybody.
Yeah, exactly.
Sir, only thing if suppose considering that I am a restaurant only providing rice or something like that. So if I take up this rice is exempted. So if I take it as a sale of goods, then so without that I would be attracting 5%. So there is a two-way sword, no?
Because So if you actually look at it, this 5% rate is actually harmful to all restaurants because they are not getting food tax credit.
The question Umang, sorry to interrupt. The question is not whether it is harmful or it is not harmful. The question is that when you are giving an interpretation of restaurant service, at the first stage, there has to be a restaurant. Now, restaurant as a term is defined under the BMC laws. Restaurants have certain specific licenses. Restaurants have a need of certain specific things to do. Now, going by that, whether you can say cloud kitchen is a restaurant, merely you are not taxing the services of cooking. You are taxing the services of restaurant. Cloud kitchen is selling goods. It is selling to everybody. There is no place over there to sit or take it away and then eat even outside that particular cloud kitchen. Cloud kitchen means you are making a food and supplying food. Cloud kitchen means you are making a food, you're manufacturing goods, and you are supplying those goods. It does not mean that you are rendering any sort of services, leave alone restaurant services. So when you are interpreting the term restaurant service, it is like jisne representation kiya, jiske dwara jitna achha representation hua, by achha you have to understand the terms achha, then you are getting that clarification. Otherwise, that clarification goes against you. See, it is a prerogative of the government whether to tax at 5% without ITC or to tax at 18%. We have no issues to that. It is a prerogative of the government. Let them tax the way they want it. But the question is that when you are interpreting restaurant service, there has to be a restaurant. You can't say it is not a restaurant. As far as ice creams are concerned, again, I agree there's a two-way sword. But you prove that an ice cream parlor is a restaurant, or you prove that an ice cream parlor is not a restaurant. If the licenses of the restaurant, they say you are going to any shop today, everybody keeps packed food. You go to your Kirana Wala, he keeps samosas also. Okay, fresh samosas. Some samosas have a shelf life of 8 days. Some samosas have shelf life of 2 days. Now you buy that samosa. Your son wants to eat it. So you will open it there only and make it, give him one samosa now because he's very hungry. Does that mean that that Kirana Wala has become a restaurant? So it is, you know, although you can keep on arguing, there can be reams and reams of interpretational issues in this. But ultimately, I think somebody will have to take a call, do a writ petition or fight out the case. You know, firstly, they were against one ice cream parlor who was charging 18% and creating credit. Now they are against all of the balance of them saying that you have wrongly paid 5%, you need to pay 18%. So they are out there to destroy the business either in one way or the other way.
Only thing is, sir, restaurant service, when they are defined, no, they are defined means supply by way of or part of a service. So there has to be some service in that.
Exactly. So when you are saying cloud kitchen, you tell me what is the service?
Yes. There is
you are just packing the food and supplying the food. When you say as a part of any service means practically, see, if you go to a restaurant as per MRP laws, you are supposed to charge as per MRP. But when you go to a restaurant, the same 20 rupees bottle is charged to you as 50 rupees. Why? What they do is they open the cap and pour the water in the glass. That is the service.
Correct, sir.
So there has to be a setup whereby a service is rendered, can be rendered, and would be rendered. So for rendering the service, there has to be a supply by way of as a part of any service.
Agree. Sir, agree, sir. Raju, sir, your views?
For example, I agree that the term restaurant service has been defined for the purpose of this notification. And a very important thing here is the supply of food should be a part of service, which Vikram has rightly stated. I agree. So predominantly, it is a service, and during that service, the goods has to be supplied as they say part of service, that being a food or article of consumption. But very important point here is that it should be service should be provided by restaurant eating joint, including mess and canteen. So principle of nositus is, you know, you need to take the term like he was giving the example, Vikram's Kirana merchant. Yes, that cannot be comparable with restaurant eating joint. Kirana merchant is for selling the goods, food. Food may be samosa or whatever, vada pav is selling is one of the products. But it is not comparable at all with the restaurant eating joint, mess or canteen. But this, because these are the terms basically where they are in the business of selling food along with the services, service dominantly, and with during the course of service they are fully supplying the goods, which is not the case in Kirana merchant. That's one part. And secondly, the restaurant service is concerned, the licenses etc. are the other requirement, which normally the law is different for the Kirana store. In your example, you have taken an ice cream parlor. Now there are, in your case, ice cream parlors are concerned, there are different modus operandi. I think specifically in your question, you have stated a nitrogen ice cream. Nitrogen ice cream you have written. Nitrogen ice creams are concerned are specifically made to order, means they are not ready. You need to select the one of the flavor, whatever options available, and in front of you only they make it. So there is no cooking involved, but there is a making definitely involved. I personally feel the cooking and making is a two different thing altogether. Okay. Like that, the falooda also do require making, but there is no cooking involved. So can you say just somebody makes falooda is cooking? No, according to me. But making, yes. So in nitrogen ice cream also, there is some machines they have, and with the help of equipments and machine, they make ice cream for you, which is what you have been, you know, in your example is. So in my view, it's very difficult to classify these under restaurant service. In my view, they are in the business of sale of ice cream only. This is my view. Of course, it is not free from litigation.
Anyone else want to contribute? Aniruddha, sir, Bijal Doshi.
Can I come in for a minute?
Yeah, sure, sir.
See, one more thing. I mean, I fully agree with Rajiv bhai that Kirana stores is not comparable. I fully agree. But cloud kitchen again, we since there was a reference to cloud kitchen, I gave an example of cloud kitchen. In cloud kitchen also, there is no provision. See, anything can be made to order. Merely because it is made to order, it does not mean that there's a service involved in it. Ultimately, after making it, you are giving it to him.
The
understanding of restaurant service is that while rendering the service, food is a part of service. Whereas in a cloud kitchen, food is the thing which you are supplying, which can be a part of a restaurant service later on or subsequently. So I was trying to distinguish that. I fully agree with what Rajiv bhai has said.
Hey Vikram, I think you are of the view on cloud kitchen whether it is covered in restaurant. My view is no, it is not restaurant. That is what I am trying to say.
But they have clarified that cloud kitchen will be charging 5%.
Yeah, you are on the circular with a due respect to the government, whatever. But I don't agree with the view given in circular, because cloud kitchen is concerned is located at XYZ place. Perhaps you may not be aware of also.
Absolutely,
and you are placing the order on portal and the goods will be delivered. So like that, the demand is also concerned. You can go to the portal and place the order and they will supply you items of food. What all is available. So it is a delivery of food. You may ask for idli, tapi, whatever you want. That is a, of course, you may call it a food, but it is a goods otherwise, in any case.
Yes,
and giving delivery is not a service. Because if giving delivery is a service, then demand will also become service provider.
Yes.
So to that extent, with due respect, I don't agree with the views given in a circular. It's a more debatable to that extent. Cooking also will be playing important role. I think current, because rate of tax on restaurant is 5%, but vanilla sale of ice cream, like plain ice cream, like we have a lot of ice cream companies are there, Vadilal, etc., where you don't require to do anything. It comes in a packs and you sell the packs. So there the item rate should be 18% and you should get ITC also. Why 5%? So in your example, you are given nitrogen ice cream, then that is only making and not cooking. So I think one has to be very careful while handling this issue. That is what is, of course, interesting issue. But
sir, only one thing over here. If you look at the scheme of classification given under the notification, restaurant service, over there they have provided restaurant service includes service provided by restaurant, cafes and similar eating facility, including takeaway services, room service and door delivery, door delivery of food. So whether this scheme of classification would override this means restaurant service, I agree with by way or part of the service. There should be some part of the service. So whether door delivery, we can say that there is some element of service provided to you, and the food is being delivered. So that.
Sir, Karan, you have to look at this way. In the restaurant service, no, service is a dominant thing and food become ancillary. Whereas again, in door delivery of any product, the dominant intention is to buy the product and door delivery is ancillary. The example given in composite supply in the act is that only. See, I sold you the goods and it is with transportation, insurance, etc. I mean, DMart is giving you door delivery and if they charge something, that doesn't make it service, sir. It is a goods only. So I personally feel that dominant intention has to be seen. So in ice cream parlor, you are looking forward for ice cream, which is a product and it's a goods. There is no service required. The only thing is that there may be possibility that one or two sitting, chairs, table may be there. But that's a voluntary, I mean to say that's not a requirement as per any license. They have kept it as a facility. Like so in sweet shop also, we find sometimes the chairs and tables are there. But that will not make character of that sweet shop as a restaurant. It still remains a sweet shop only. Cake, pastry, sweets, etc. So it will never become hotel or restaurant in that case. This is what is there. Of course, we can debate on and on, but this is my view on that.
Okay. So we are over this circular is not so much important. There is a different, maybe the circular and we have something else on this thing. Now going forward, Now what we were arguing about, this is the case study 8. Natural Ice Cream is engaged in the business of selling ice cream for its parlor. It has two types of models. First model is directly counter sale of pre-prepared ice cream. Means the ice cream come from the vendor of the natural ice cream. He just stores the ice cream in a cold storage, and then whenever the customer comes, he gives him the ice cream. That is direct counter sale of pre-prepared ice cream. And second one is live roll ice cream. What is this live roll ice cream? Over here, we have to select the flavor or the cake which you want to take, and then they pour the milk on the same, and under the controlled environment, they make the ice cream for you. Similar to some Faluda. Similar to Faluda. Faluda also, they mix 2-3 items. Ice cream they put the save and all that, and then they give the Faluda. So whether this is a so what will be the rate of GST on direct sale of pre-prepared ice cream and live roll ice cream is the issue. Anyone want to contribute other than who are contributing? Maybe Bijal Doshi or Sanjay Ji, Jay Prakash Chauhan. Okay. Umang, by your views on this?
This is actually not clarified, and this is also not free from doubt. It's like Faluda served in restaurant and Faluda served at ice cream parlor. One place, if you say that it is given during restaurant service, it is charged at 15%. Then what about this place? So, you know, it is not free from doubt, and if all licenses and all are there, then you know you can argue that this becomes part of a restaurant service, and you could be in a position to supply it at another rate, restaurant rate
5%, correct? Yes. The circular word given by department is that ice cream parlor sells already manufactured ice cream, and they do not have any character of a restaurant. Ice cream parlor do not engage in any form of cooking at any stage, whereas restaurant service involves the aspect of cooking preparing during the course of providing service. Thus, the supply of ice cream parlor stands on the different footing that restaurant service, their activity and the supply of ice cream as a good that is manufactured and not as a service. Here, I want to just tell, they have used the word restaurant service involves aspect of cooking preparing. And they are telling that ice cream parlor does not involve cooking or preparing. Is this true? Ice cream parlor always don't prepare. In our example, they are preparing the ice cream. That is live ice cream they are giving. So whether this circular, whether all the ice cream parlor will fall under this and 18% would be charged, or where the ice cream is made, live made. So that would be a restaurant service and attract at 5%. Sir, your views on this?
Can anybody, Karan, do you distinguish between the two ice creams? See, making an ice cream, he is supposing you ask vanilla pineapple together. Okay. So he will take a scoop of vanilla, he'll take a scoop of pineapple. Okay. Or you will have that softy machine where half of the vanilla and half of the pineapple will come. So there also you're making, no, anything. It's like a mixing of two products. So when you're saying it is a roll, it is a pre-prepared ice cream. You are just laying it out and re-rolling it and putting a chocolate over it. So it is all ice cream. It is just a mixture of two or more ice creams which you are selling.
Correct.
Okay, it continues to remain as an ice cream, and what you are selling is also an ice cream. Certain ice creams are already made because they are three distinct things which are mixed together, and you have all those three things together at your place. You are making the two, three things together and giving it to him. Does that change the nature of the character of ice cream per se? It continues to remain as an ice cream.
So three schools together, you call it Sunday, but it continues to be ice cream is what he's trying to say.
Correct. So sir, what about Faluda made at the ice cream parlor? Vikram bhai? Hello?
Seems like,
sorry,
I don't know.
Sorry, yeah. Yeah, it was mute. See, because you're adding two, three contents. See, Faluda, you are knowing it, that is a different product. Similarly, Sunday is also a different product. Marketing wise, you know it as a different product. But as a manufacturer, I know that when I have to do a Sunday, I have to add three, four ice creams. I have to put some nuts over it and that's a Sunday. Similarly, when you're selling a Faluda, you know that you're going to add a tinge of Takmaria. You're going to take the base of rose and then you're going to put an ice cream scoop over it and you say Faluda ice cream.
Correct.
So merely because you're making it or it's a different variety of ice cream. So I think we are going a bit away from whether there is any restaurant service in it. That is the question which we need to answer. Every time you're making a sale of ice cream, because that ice cream continues to remain ice cream. You have to take a clue from that where you are making a ship. The person who's giving you order of the ship, he'll give you the order is of crores of rupees. So he will say, I want the hulk of this nature. I want the rope of this make. It has to be designed in this fashion. But ultimately in doing all this also, ultimately you are selling a product which is a ship. Therefore, taking that same analogy over here, there may be 10 variants. You may have to do different things ultimately to deliver that product. But end of the day, there is no restaurant service because restaurant service will begin before service of food. So the person will go to a particular joint for a service which will include food. Whereas when you go to an ice cream parlor, you're going for an ice cream. You are not going for an ambience or X, Y, Z. Of course, that is practical aspect of it. But you're going for an ice cream. Because you like Naturals ice cream, you go to Naturals. Because you like a Vadilal's ka cone, you will go and buy Vadilal. But they are still products. Branded products. You like some. That's it. Does that make a restaurant service?
Correct.
That is the question which we need to answer.
Raju sir, your views on this?
See, I agree with what Vikram say, because your issue is more about whether it is a, what is the rate of tax on these, whether it is restaurants, or we are debating on that. So whether it is Sunday or Faluda, everything is ultimately ice cream only. It's a variety of ice cream. And how far, first of all, only we can debate then is, first of all, whether it is supplied by a restaurant, eating house, eating joint. No, actually it's a parlor, and parlor is definitely not comparable with a restaurant or eating joint or mess, as the case may be. That is one. Secondly, there is no cooking involved, and in normally in the restaurant service, cooking has to be there. That is what my understanding means. You should have cooking facility as well as you should have a serving facilities, then only it will make a restaurant. That's why kitchen is concerned. I don't agree it is a restaurant, although circular says the other way around. So in my view, in this thing, the rate of tax on ice cream in your question should not be restaurant 5%, but it should be 18%. Of course, I am subject to this thing, but this is my view on this part, which is a bit contrary to the circular to that extent. But I agree with what Vikram said, absolutely.
So we are agreeing that this circular regarding ice cream parlor should attract a rate of GST at 18%. Okay, now going forward to next question, issue number 9. PQL Limited, a registered manufacturer, have turnover of 3 crores during financial year 2021. Sends its goods for job work in November 2021 and said goods are returned from job work within 15 days from sending of said goods. PQR wants to know whether under which form and what is the time within which he needs to declare the said transaction. And what if the turnover of PQR for financial 2021 is 7 crores. This is a bit of a very misjudged for an amendment there was an amendment by notification 35/2021 dated 24 September 21. The periodicity for the form ITC04 was increased. So rule 45 was amended, and in the rule 45 from 1st October, the details of challan in respect of goods dispatched to a job worker or received from a job worker during the specified period shall be included in ITC04. So they have increased the time limit for filing form ITC04 basically. So what is meant by specific period? If your turnover during the immediately preceding financial year is less than 5 crore rupees, then you need to file exceeds 5 crore rupees, you need to file return 6 monthly. And if your turnover is below 5 crore rupees, then you have to file only once in the year. And before this amendment, you have to file all the persons were required to file the return on quarterly basis. So by this amendment, they have just changed the timeline for filing ITC04. For below 5 crores yearly, for less than 5 crores, either 6 monthly, they have to file 2 returns. So this is a very simple question. So with this, I have completed all the case studies. Any issues on any of the case study?
I believe we'll have to conclude in the next 10 odd minutes, Karan. So okay. You the next case laws will take longer, then please give your inputs and probably we can take one more input and then close.
I will just take another 5 minutes to complete this. There is only one very important judicial decision. This is to all the person who are doing appellate job. This is very important case study, important decision of Honorable Orissa High Court. This is in case of Jyoti Construction. The issue over here was whether pre-deposit I can pay through electronic credit ledger. This is the issue. So anyone can tell ki ECL whether we can pay pre-deposit to ECL or no, electronic credit ledger. The matter has went to the High Court. The High Court has stated that pre-deposit cannot be paid through electronic credit ledger. It can be paid only to electronic cash ledger only. So what are the points on which High Court stated this? If you read section 1076 of the CGST Act, it states no appeal shall be filed unless you have paid all the admitted dues in full and some equal to 10% of the disputed dues, or 25 crores, whichever is higher. So an appeal can be filed only after making pre-deposit. Then section 49(3), the amount section 49(3) is apportionment of electronic cash ledger, how you can use the electronic cash ledger. The amount available in electronic cash ledger may be used for making payment towards tax, interest, penalty, fees, or any other amount. This means through electronic cash ledger, you can make any of the payment, either be it tax, be it penalty, be it interest, anything you can pay. Now, in what circumstance I can use electronic credit ledger? That is under section 49(4). The amount available in electronic credit ledger may be used for making any payment towards output tax. This is very important term, towards output tax. As in electronic cash ledger, I can make for tax interest. Here, I can only use electronic credit ledger for output tax only. What is mean by output tax then? So output tax is being defined means tax chargeable under this act on taxable supply of goods or services of both made by taxable person or his agent, but exclude tax payable under reverse charge mechanism. So the output tax means the tax liability which you need to pay under forward charge. Output tax means, correct? So, and then section 41, every registered person shall subject to such condition restriction entitled to take credit of eligible input tax area self-assessed. You are whatever credit you are taking till today is only on self-assessed basis only. That is provisional basis. You are taking on self-assessed, and that is a provisional credit given to you by government in electronic credit ledger. And then 41.2, the credit referred to over and above means what provisional credit you have been given by the government can be utilized only for payment of self-assessed output tax. So while filing your GSTR 3B, you are self-assessing your output tax liability. For that manner only, you can utilize your electronic credit ledger because of the restriction under 41.2. So what is mean by self? I have already stated what is mean by output tax and what is mean by self-assessment. That means every registrant shall self-assess his tax payable under this act and furnished return under this act. So by going all these things, the court has held that it is not possible to accept the plea of the petitioner that output tax could be equated to the pre-deposit requirement, because output tax means self-assessed tax. Self-assessed tax and the electronic credit ledger can be utilized only for payment of self-assessed output tax. So the court has stated that electronic credit ledger cannot be utilized for payment of pre-deposit. Then there was one circular also. Circular SENVET credit of central excise service tax wrongly carried forward as transitional credit shall be recovered as central tax liability to be paid through utilization of amount available in electronic credit ledger, electronic cash ledger. Means here if you have a liability, in service tax returns you had 1 crore of carried forward credit. So you have filed a Tran 1 form. So in Tran 1, you have carried forward electronic credit ledger, your input tax credit. Now that circular states that you can utilize that electronic credit ledger for making any tax payable of service tax or of either service tax or this thing. So this circular is contradicting to the judgment of the Jyoti Construction. This circular states that the electronic credit ledger can be used for making payment of the erstwhile service tax liability, etc. But so there is a bit of confusion on this issue, whether electronic credit ledger can be utilized, but Jyoti Construction has stated that you cannot utilize your electronic credit ledger for making payment of pre-deposit. And decision of Gujarat High Court in case of Cadila Healthcare, pre-deposit made by petitioner by utilizing SENVET gate shall be accepted for purpose of 35F. So in service tax regime also that SENVET credit was available for making payment of pre-deposit. But in the GST regime, government has smartly put the provision that electronic credit ledger can only be utilized for making payment of the self-assessed tax and not the pre-deposit amount. Umang, that's it from my side.
Yes, thank you, Karan. Over to Vikram bhai for
Umang bhai, only one thing. I would like to thank my mentors here, Raju Luthia, for all the guidance and help he has given me for giving this for making this presentation.
Wonderful. Thank you, Umang, for giving me this opportunity to thank Karan as well as Rajiv bhai. I think Rajiv bhai, you have to be prepared. You have prepared a very good competitor under you. Excellently, well laid out controversies, very well explained case studies, absolutely answered also very methodically and correctly, correct interpretation of law. Karan, we are extremely thankful to you, and I would request each one of you to digitally applaud you for the wonderful effort which you have rendered. Thank you very much for the wonderful knowledge which you have shared, and in a very lucid and entirely fabulous manner. Thank you, Karan. Thank you, Rajiv bhai. And thank you, each one of the participants, for participating and making this debate lively. Thank you.
Hey, Vikram, for your information, it was entire work by Karan only. My inputs were very good. But you did a great job, and I am really proud of
Absolutely.
You.
Absolutely.
As regarding competitor, I'll say he's already ahead of me. So now I'm taking the competition on that front.
Good, good. So you're proud to be of your competitor. No?
Yeah. Vikram, all of us are always proud when our children, you know, Rajat must be very proud when Umang is progressing. Isn't Umang correct?
Yes, absolutely, yeah. Sir. Absolutely. Yeah. What you're saying is absolutely correct, sir. Absolutely.
Fine.
Thank you, Karan. Once again. Thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
With this, we conclude the session. We will let you know about the further sessions shortly. Thank you. You can all leave. Mishra ji, aap recording band kar sakte hain.